Thank you. Praise God. How many of you happy to be here this morning? Amen. A few on this side. How many of you on this side happy to be here? All right. Amen. Amen. This is a blessed day because it's the day that the Lord has made. And we are rejoicing in it. Not we will rejoice. We are rejoicing. Amen. 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 Well, I was not scheduled to stand here this morning. This is Sister Deborah Williams. She called me about 8:30 and said both of her cars were, the tires were down on them. And she was gonna try to get them up, try to make it, but she didn't know if she would. So she has a program and everything with her, but we have consulted and we're gonna go right on with it, amen? Amen. How many of you know, okay, this is the last day of 2017. Am I right? Oh, we thank God for the praise team. They were just awesome, and the musicians. Let's give them a hand. Yes, yes, yes. I just made a few notes on the song, Show Yourself Mighty, Show Yourself Strong in the Midst of the Storm. Hasn't he done that in your life? During 2017, he's shown, well, I know in my life, he's shown himself mighty and he's shown himself strong. And another song they sang, Holy, Holy, Holy is the Lord God Almighty. He's worthy to receive glory, honor, and our praises. Let us not think that what we have done, our accomplishment, is because of all of that. But he's the one that has given us the ability to do what we do. Am I right? Am I right, Justice? How many of you saw him make that last run? Yeah. We were out cheering for him. And we were cheering that he made it home, that he made it home. He didn't. Did you make it home, Justice? Not that last one. Well, anyway, it was a good game. But how many of you know that that's not of his own might? Now, he works out and all, but he gives God the glory. And we want you to continue to give God the glory. And all of these athletes, and you don't have to be an athlete. Whatever your endeavor is, make sure you give God the glory for what he has deposited in you. Amen? Praise the Lord. Okay. I think the last song, well, that was the same one. But anyway, I was sitting there reflecting on, we've got a good program today coming up for you. The blessings of 2017. Yeah. I want you to think of the times that you were driving and you were maybe occupied with where you were going or what you were going to do that day or the next day. Like Pastor, let me tell you something, since he injected that. It's just us here, amen. When we go someplace and he's driving, I tell him where to turn, you know, you should do this and that. He said, why don't you just drive? I said, no, you go on and drive. But he needs help. He needs help when he's driving, you know. I remember when Dax was a younger and Pastor would take him to school and drop him off sometimes. And one time I was making a comment that Pastor couldn't drive, and I meant he was not the best driver. And Dax said, honey can drive because he takes me to school every day. I'm like, okay, Dax. Well, anyway, reflect upon the times that you nearly had an accident. And God dispensed his angels. Glory to God, I've been there. And you just say, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you spared me. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And you wonder, how did it happen? But it was God, amen. Save you from disaster. Think about those times when you may have been sick, and the doctors may have thought you were sick unto death, but you said, not so. Not so. the doctors don't have the last word over me. We have people sitting in our midst today that can that's been restored to health. We've heard those testimonies. Think of the times when God gave you peace in the midst of the storm. And it could be a literal storm. It could be whatever storm you're having in your life. And when you're going through it, it seems like this is it. I can't get through this. But how many of you know you look back and you can see all those times that God delivered you and brought you out of the midst of the storm? Many, many times. I'm just talking about in the blessings in 2017. And I could enumerate more and more, but we've got some people that's going to come and share those blessings with us. And we've got a dynamic speaker this morning, so I'm not going to stand and take too much time. We have three people that's going to come and share the blessings of the Lord and to give us some praise reports. I want you to put your hands together and welcome our first one, Sister Yvonne Bice. Yes, how the Lord has blessed her. Amen. Oh, how he's blessed her. I think she's had four back surgeries, but I'm gonna let her tell it. I can't tell it like she can tell it. She's coming, Sister Bice. Sister Yvonne Bice with a praise report. Praise the Lord. Amen, amen, amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Give glory to my Father in heaven, my church family, my pastor and his wife, Pastor Williams and his wife, everybody. I just love you. And I give you all the praise and glory to our Heavenly Father for you.
Amen.
Well, I'm going to just try to catch you up a little bit. My problem started back in 2005. That was my first back surgery. When I came out of that, my feet was numb and legs numb. But I could move. I mean, in 2006, I had another back surgery where the hardware they put in my back was pinching me. So they had to go back in, so that's the second. And then still in 2006, I had colon cancer. Lord had been blessing me all along. And then in 2012, I had two back surgeries. One was my fault. I had surgery in January. In June, I fell backwards off my steps. So that December, he had to do another surgery. But that was mine. When I went to him, his name was Clinton Bird. I said, "You're a praying doctor." He was an MD. He said, "Yes, I am." I said, "Thank you, Lord, thank you." And January of this year, January when it started, I started having this pinched nerve again. That's what all caused this back problem. And I asked my doctor, could I get Clinton Bird to do my surgery? Insurance didn't cover him. I had changed from January when I asked her I needed to see him, he said, "Well, we'll call you when we get your appointment in with him, because you got to be referred to these doctors." 3 months later, still hadn't had no call from no one. So when I went to see her in June, I said, "Ain't no one called me about my back." She said, "Well, why'd you wait?" I said, "You told me." I said, "I know not to listen to you anymore about that." So I asked him again for Clinton Bird. She said, "Okay, we'll see if we can get him." 2 days later, he called me back. They couldn't get him. So they recommended this Dr. Gregory Wilson. So I looked him up to try to get some information on it. And I called my insurance company. They said they cover him. I said, "But I ain't used to no DO. I don't know too much about their work. I guess they're okay, but that's who I shouldn't have been asking. I should have been asking God, what should I do? I should have been on my knees praying, is this man a praying God?" Things went so fast after June. Went to see him, He took all kind of tests, MRIs, just, but anyway, back to me. And from June to August, I was taking EKGs, you name the tests, they were running everything from here to y'all know me. I was praying, but sometimes you just need a little encouragement from your elders. Go in and ask them, pray for me, I'm going into this. And I need a little extra prayer other than my own. And I didn't do that. And I paid for it. I paid dearly. So August 31st is when he was going to do this one day surgery on my back. He was going to go in and clean out this little tunnel where the nerves was pinching because it didn't get clogged up. He's going to just do this little one day surgery. I went in there. When I woke up in recovery, all I could do was, oh, and it was on my right leg. That's the one was pinching nerves and couldn't move, couldn't walk. When I woke up in recovery, I grabbed my left leg. It was paining so bad. I woke up screaming. So they running over there, asking me what's my problem. I said, what's your problem? I'm the one hurting. I am hurting to the extent it ain't even in my right leg, it's in my left. They start calling Dr. Wilson and asking him, what should we do? Give us some more steroids, do this. And I said, oh Lord, I knew. I didn't have enough faith in him in the first place. Why did I let him do it? I should have waited on God. That's what I should have done. And from that, on the 31st, getting out of recovery, they had to lift me up off the bed, put me in a wheelchair, push me in this room, because one day surgery, they make you go home. And when my mom and my sister drove around to pick me up, they struggled to get me in the car because I couldn't stand up. That leg was still just numb. And the guy who, and I will, he must have been wore out because he was breathing so hard when he pushed me in the car. He said the statement, I don't know how them two old ladies are going to get her out of the car. That's what he said. That's what they said. And then after that, we got home. Mama bagged up to my steps. If y'all ever been to my house, I got two steps. My sister and her friend came over, and I told my mama I need my walker. I can't do it. They goes in, get the walker, put it right in front of the door, and I'm getting out the car, and all I did is went down to the ground. Y'all seen them three trying to pick me up. The guy said, oh no, she's too heavy. She heavy, so she like laying. I had to crawl from that door on the ground through the grass, and my mama was in the door throwing out pillows, throwing out covers, so I wouldn't scratch my leg going across the cement. I crawled up, I pulled myself, it was just like in the Vietnam War, I was doing this, pulling the grass, trying to make it into the house. I got up on the steps, crawling up on the steps, and the guy, I got wood floors if you ever seen, took my hand and drug me across the floor because I had the slippery thing so he could pull me in. So when I got in the bedroom, I still crawling. And to get in the bed, I kneeled down like I was praying and they shoved me over in the bed. I got in that bed, that was about 4 o'clock that evening. And I told Mama, it'll probably come back later. Just put me some bottles of water around the bed. Because I like to drink water. I think she put out 4 or 5 bottles of water. I told her, go on, I'll be all right. The first time I woke up to try to go to the restroom, I got on that leg and went down to the bed. I had drunk a bottle of water up. And I searched on that bed because they had put all my paperwork. And I found that doctor's number. I said, let me tell you something. They sent me home and I couldn't walk. Why come they didn't notify you that I couldn't walk? They just threw me in the car and that was it. He said, well, come back to the emergency room. And I said, I cannot walk. He said, well, get an ambulance and I'll meet you there. Okay, the ambulance came. And I got a desk chair that rolls. They had to put me in this desk wheelchair to roll me out to the front room to get on the stretcher. But my mama, she stood by me. Ooh, my sister stood by me. Oh, God was with us. They got me back to the hospital. They started running some more tests. I laid in that emergency room about 4 o'clock Thursday before they could get me a room. When I got that room, 8 o'clock that night, they was taking me back to surgery. So this is about the sixth back surgery I done had. When I came out of surgery, they had a tube in my back to drain the blood. And I told him, I'm paralyzed, you paralyzed me. He said, can you feel my hand on your leg? I told him, yeah, I can feel it. He said, well, then you ain't paralyzed. But when a person can't walk, I'm paralyzed. So when I got up Friday, when I woke up Friday morning, I felt that tube in my back. I said, oh, Lord, another surgery. Six surgery in my back. And this back brace I done bought, it's supposed to be put on me after the first that first surgery done. I ain't had that back brace on yet. I told him, can you take this back brace back? I done paid $100 for it and they ain't used it. No, we can't take it back. That's how they do you. But I stayed in that hospital. I supposed to been helping my mother. It was the Labor Day weekend because we had people coming from out of town. I'm laying in the hospital. I stayed in the hospital 5 days and couldn't move. But Sister Wayne, praise God, Sister Wayne brought me a packet out. And in that packet, it was my healing covenant decoration from Pastor Hill. And the point I like best is your word, Father, shows us how Israel lived under and adhered to the covenant of healing for 450 years in one unbroken chain of time, a nation of millions. They had no doctors and they had no medicine. They trusted you and you alone for all their spiritual and physical needs of life. And they were all met by your word and by your power. That's in Exodus 15 and 16. This is from Pastor Hill, our elder. You know, that's what I read. And the next day, I still couldn't move my leg. My leg was just, then it was the left leg, it wasn't the one. But he had blowed some nerve and it swollen up, a hematoma or something, he said. The next day, Pastor Hill, Sister Wayne, they was there at my bedside. And they prayed, and I tell you, it was the people in the, I had to share a room, people in the other room had heard their prayers, and they started praying too. And when they left that night, I could feel warmth running down my leg. Ah! I could feel the warmth. I said, oh, I know it's you, Lord. The prayer went through me down my leg. But you know, after 5 days in the hospital, I still couldn't, I could stand up. But I was on a walker, so they wanted me to go to rehab next door. I had to go to rehab. They wanted me to be in there, they said, 7 to 10 days. I started praying. I said, I ain't gonna be in here no 10 days in this rehab. I even ran into Sister Sheila. I think that's her name. Yeah, I was on a walker. She Steven. We hugged and she was this time that I think Brother Wayne and Sister Wayne's daughter was having a baby. I was in rehab. She was on one floor and I was taking therapy on the next. And I stayed 4 days because I was praying. I said, let me get up out of here and start. I'm going to get through quick and get to walking. After I got home, they wanted to send me through physical therapy for 16 times. I started praying to God. Jesus, I don't want this. I'm dependent on you. I went 4 times. And then I called them. I said, I'm not coming back because I had to pay $35 every time I went. So they said it the long way out. I said, no, I'm not coming back. He said, can I come one time? Can I just come back? I need to make an ending report on you. I said, you're gonna pay the $30. But I went on, but I went on back and I, so it made six times. But I wasn't going no 16 times for physical therapy because I depended on Jesus for my help. Because when I went home from physical therapy and I had to lay on this mat to exercise my own leg, I said, Jesus, raise it up. Move it. He moved it. He moved it. And there's some songs that I really loved and I would do exercise with. And they say the mouth of babes, my little great grandbaby, wanted to be here today when I did this. Cause she had got a song. She said, Granny, let's do this song together. I said, what did you choose? She said, I chose Yes You Can. So we both been doing this little step to Yes You Can. Cause God said you can and you can. And it's another song, he say, won't he do it? Won't God do it? And then it's another one by Luther Barnes, he said, God's grace. I just love songs, the music, it moves me. And it was one about John P. Key. And he said, clap your hands. He said, if God have blessed you for anything, and I know people in here have been blessed, Denise, Sister Judy, Brother Wayne, Brother John, Pastor Hill, and this is just healing people. Sister, and I'm not going to try to name them all, Sister Dorothy, but we didn't all have something that we didn't have had to thank the Lord for bringing us through. My mom, and he's done it. And so the last thing I'm going to say, if God has done something for you, stand up and clap your hands, because I can tell you.
Could talk like that, did you? She gave the details. That's a walking miracle. Look what God can do. Amen, 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 amen. But look at all the ones she named that God performed miracles on, our pastor and our sister, all the ones she enumerated, and those that were not enumerated. There have been others that God has delivered. Glory to God. Didn't I tell you that God can do it, it just can't be done. Amen, amen. He's a miracle working God. How many of you expect a miracle every day? If you haven't, I want you in 2018, expect a miracle every day. Expect it. Sometimes we don't get because we don't expect. And if we expect things, we begin to look for them. Amen. Thank you, Sister Bikes. That was really, really a blessing. We're moving on. We have two more. The next person is probably a little briefer than Sister Bikes, but we enjoyed her so much. Kimberly Thrower, would you come at this time? Amen. Well, she has her. Okay. All right, she's ready too. Amen. Amen, amen. This is my baby girl. Older one. I'm not the baby. Happy New Year's
Happy
Eve.
Happy New Year's Eve.
How many of you out there have 2018 resolutions or goals? And how many of you are going to work towards making those goals a reality in 2018. Awesome, awesome, awesome. James 2:17, the New International Version translation says, in the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. The Prosperity Confession found in page 4 of our Prevailing Prayer and Confessions Declaration booklet compiled by our pastor acknowledges us to claim what's ours as Abraham's seed and heir. I consistently confess
that I would use God's power to get wealth. And I believe I receive wealth in every form that God chooses to get it to me. And I add, without hurting or harming any family or friends. And I believe I receive wealth in every form that God chooses to get it to me, including wisdom and faith, favor, revelation knowledge, and the anointing for increase, creative ideas, jobs, and promotions. And it goes on and on. I desired in the year 2017 that we are ending today, and I prepared myself. That's the works. I had faith, but I acted. I prepared myself to receive an increase through self-assessing my work performance, accomplishments, work ethic, my attitude, my skills and training, and bringing that forth to my immediate supervisor's attention. Not that she didn't recognize it, but I wanted to make sure that my confession and my action was put into practice. And I told her that I desired a raise, or a promotion, I should say, because a raise is something different. A promotion is at the next level of position. And with that comes a raise, as you know. So by speaking that into confession on a daily basis and then bringing that to her attention, because I just didn't go around thinking, well, she knows I deserve a promotion and it's going to happen. It's all in here. But you have to sometimes put it verbally and in writing. So the first encounter with my supervisor, she acknowledged that I deserved a promotion and that they would see what they could do to accommodate the promotion within a certain time frame, and that was within a couple of months. So after 6 months went by and I didn't perceive anything transpire, I approached her again on the same topic and kind of went through the same process again. And then she said, okay, now follow this procedure to complete this application and so forth. And we're going to do it. We're going to do it. And in about 3 weeks after that last encounter, my paycheck reflected a promotion. So, you know, I say that to say that not only our daily confessions are our verbal daily confessions are important out loud, but you also have to have goals and a vision of what you want for yourself in your life, whether it's 2018, 2019, or going forward, and whether that's from a physical perspective, a healing, health perspective for you or your family, or financially for you and your family, the ministry, or whether or not it's just family matters in general, you know, being able to get along and communicate better with your family, whatever your goal is. Not only confess it verbally, but do what it takes to make that a reality. So, long story short, so what I'm declaring for 2018 is wealth and riches come to me and my household so that I can be a further blessing to the ministry and to my family and friends and myself. So I encourage you for 2018 to not only write down your goals, verbally confess what it is that you desire. And in this booklet, it covers prosperity, healing, your family, the church, intercession. It has tons of topics that you can confess on a daily basis for and work towards completing that goal, and you will see it become reality. Yes. Happy New Year.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God. We thank God for that. That how she challenged us. Amen. And I believe I heard Kimberly say there are certain confessions that she reads. And every day, is that the one? Almost every day, confessions. And how many of you know if you do it every day, it becomes a part of you. It becomes a part of it. Amen, amen. Okay, we're going to move on because we don't want to take too much time from our speaker. But we have one more person coming. And how many of you know that sometimes when you get up, I think I told these ladies about 5 minutes each. But we enjoyed them so much. And I wanted to mention something about goals just before our next speaker, our next praise reporter comes. Goals, I don't know. We're not going to call him today because it's Women's Day. But Justice had a goal, I think. Did you not have a goal? I've seen you on TV talking about your goals and what have you. And I think his goal was like 1,500 rushing yards this year. And how many of you know he came really close to that? 1,400 and I've been keeping up with him, but help me. You don't know? Where's Mama? 1,400 and I think 67. Brother Travis? Oh, okay, 1,400. He came really close to that goal. Really, really close to that goal. But the first of the year, he set that goal. And I tell you, whenever I saw him, he got beat up out there and all these big whoever crushing on him. And I would holler at the TV and say, y'all get up off of him. You hurt him, you know, whatever. But anyway, he just kept pressing and kept pressing. So whatever your goal, you may not be on the football field or 15 touchdowns, yes. What? Reach that goal. Amen. So he's expecting bigger and better things. Somebody over here is talking to me. What? 1467. All right, that's it. Okay, 1467. Almost reached the 15. Suppose he had not set a goal. I don't know what would have happened. He probably wouldn't have worked as hard or as diligent. Yeah, with his receiving yards, more than 15. So we want to congratulate you. You're not on the program today, though. Okay, our next speaker, our next praise reporter. See, God has just done so much. That's why people have so much to talk about. Amen. Come on, Sister Wayne.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Sister Hill asked me to. I'm supposed to be a backup, and I guess I'm this backup today. But I thank God that I always have a testimony. Every day, new mercies I see. I thank God for what he's done for me in this 2017. I asked the Lord. I was in Bible study one night, and I'm like, I don't know how the subject came up, but I was like, I know Sister Denise's gifts, you know, Brother Wayne's, but, you know, I questioned the Lord, what is my gifts? And I tell you, he spoke to me in the middle of the night while I was asleep. He gave me a song, I was created to glorify him. We all were created to glorify and magnify him. But he also has been revealing or helping me to move in the ministry that he's given me. The gifts and talents he's given everybody. Everybody has gifts and talents. I might not can sing like Sister Dorothy over there, but I can make a joyful noise. Hey, praise the Lord. But this year, I know the scripture where he says that when you're faithful over the little things, he'll make you, will give you much more to do. So, and this year, I know I heard Pastor Hill say, who would ever thought Sister Wayne would be a leader, trying to be a leader or something, a group. But I thank God for the care group, the care. Someone came to me, someone that came to our church, and she was saying, well, we don't have, where she was from, they had this going on and that. I said, well, it might not have been functioning, but we can get it started. We can start calling, though. I mean, the people that's in the care group, they were already doing this. They were already calling and encouraging. And the Lord just said, we can be unified and where we can make sure we meet all the needs or as much as we can, encourage, pray with. You know, we can't do anything about what we haven't done, but we can do better. We can ask the Lord to help us to do better. So I thank God how he started the care group where we can call and encourage one another. And I hope that if it's anybody that hasn't been called that need to be called, give us your name, because we try to split up the names and we all take some and call and encourage and pray with. And even have Bible study if you need it. So I'm just thankful for what the Lord has been doing in me and developing the gifts, helping me to develop the gifts that he given me. I was so thankful when Sister Kim came, brought her back, because it seemed like what she does, I mean, meticulous with what she does, excellent, the spirit of excellence. But it's like she's so many levels above, but I'm like, I'm still in the ball game. I can help. I'm a helper, and I don't mind helping. And I thank God that all the ladies in the care group, we're helpers, want to help and encourage and pray with. So I'm excited about what he did in 2017 through me. And let me know, he said, we're the body of Christ. Amen. We all are the body of Christ. That's what he gave me. And that every member, every part of the body is important. Every part. So if you're part of the body, we receive Jesus in him. That means the love of God in us. Then every part of us should be flowing. The blood, when the blood in our body, it flows from one part to the other. This is what he's been telling me, that we're connected. And like my hand here, this hand, it would not take, it's part of this body. If this foot is hurting, it's going to reach down and help. It's not going to hurt, start slapping. So we got to realize that we are all part of the body. And the Holy Spirit will reveal to us when we're hurting and need ministering, rubbing on and encouraging. And so I'm just saying thankful for what the Lord has been doing and what he's given me more. I'm excited about what he's going to do in 2018. I'm excited about bringing the body together, the children ministry and the things that they did, and we were able to help them. You know, not just make up things for them to do, but we all can help. Like she said, we can come over there. I pass out snacks. Y'all see me more tonight. I'm passing out snacks. I'm proud of it. Thank the Lord can use me. You know, so fact. You know, if you're wondering what you're part of the body, what see what the Lord say you can do. So we all should be functioning, because no part of our body should not be doing. Every part has something to do. And it should not be stagnant. You know, it should be moving. And so we pray going into the next year that we fit knit closer together to do the work of the Lord. Yeah. Praise God.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Wayne. Amen. James 2:17, the New International Version translation says, in the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. The prosperity confession found in page 4 of our Prevailing Prayer and Confessions Declaration booklet compiled by our pastor acknowledges us to claim what's ours as Abraham's seed and heir. I consistently confess that I will use God's power to get wealth. And I believe I receive wealth in every form.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, moving in our midst. Oh.